So in customs broker exam, I have this dedicated link to licensed customs broker exam page on the cbp.gov site. And this site gives you a general overview of how to become a licensed customs broker. And here, as you can see by the link, you can go there and read it for yourself. But in a nutshell, the customs exam is a test, as we mentioned before, of HTSUS, Code of Federal Regulations Title 19, directives which were made pursuant to the regulations. In other words, it's kind of like fill in the blanks for the regulations, clarification of things. And probably KTR. KTR is mostly the technical information inquiry. So, for example, what type of code you must put in if you see that error message, or what does that error message signify, stand for? Or if you get this code, what do you do? Mostly it's becoming outdated. I see less and less questions on KTR stuff simply because there is a significant change from US from ACS, Automated Commercial System, which is a platform customs is still currently using somewhat, to ACE, which is called Automated Commercial Environment. It's a middleware or web internet-based system, and there is a lot of problems. So remember I talked about the proposed rule. So let's go back to the proposed rule. Right, see the proposed rulemaking in case of ACE or Automated Commercial Environment implementation, customs has been delaying it. So will there be a delay with this? I do not know. But there has been significant pushback from powerful members of the trade community, from lobbying groups, to delay this, because the transition, especially for the big players, is costly. And it requires training, it requires troubleshooting, it requires a lot of nooks and crannies, if you will, to get this up and running, as well as on both sides. If you'd like to see it in the real world, subscribe to go to cbp.gov and subscribe to this messaging system, and you see a lot of error messages where customs says, okay, customs CBP is aware that trade is experiencing these technical issues, so etc. CBP is working on it. And those come up so frequently that it gives you a picture that there is still a lot of work to be done on the system itself. So that's but basically this is the statement of position. It doesn't phase out the paper stuff that you can bring, at least not notice. So I'm going with the assumption that you can still bring all the stuff in, all the relevant materials. No electronic stuff that can help you out to get significant advantage, such as tablets, laptops, all that smart stuff. My understanding is calculators are still allowed. Watches, which is simple watch like that, not those eye watches, they would be still allowed. And I suggest you bring those, because first of all, this is a good ability to time yourself, and the calculator will save you a lot of time, unless you are a very mathematically driven person. To when you calculate duty rates or deal with evaluation questions. Alright, so that's transition to the computer. Alright, increasing examination fee, that's a big one. So for those of us marginalized members of the society, I'm speaking relatively, the fee right now, or what it was $200, right? To get a seat, to get your ticket in into the exciting world of customs broker examination and have your opportunity to take a stab on it and pass. It goes up to $390, almost doubles. So $390. So Customs Express makes an expression of, gives highly technical explanation, says it's minor. It says that this is really to, they call it a transfer fee, because it's merely used to offset the cost of administration. Their mathematical methodology, at least as we shall see in one of the letters of the commenters, is maybe dubious, at least their calculation methodology raises some questions, but nevertheless, that's what customs would like to see, $390. And they would like to adjust the dates of examination. So it was first Monday of either October or April. Okay? Now they want to make it fourth. Last Monday of October and April. All right. So what does it mean for us? For us, it means that we will have. For us, it means that we are going to have more time to prepare, which is a good thing. So instead of like April 3rd or 4th or 5th or whatever that is, it moved. Customs explains it by the change of in fiscal practices by the federal government. They also mentioned some kind of fiscal uncertainty, so as to imply that nothing in this world, even the fiscal policy of the federal government, is uncertain. So this is they would like to shift the dates farther out. All right. So this is adjustment in the examination dates. I, in essence, this is what this 12-page summary looks like. Here's what customs say. The examination will be held at private testing centers and administered by professional proctors. All right. So one of the reasons to as a shift to the higher rate is they say, okay, it used to be customs officers which were handing out papers. Now apparently customs officers are not good enough. Don't know why, but now. So since customs officers would go out and do this, they would get paid anyway, right? Now it would be the outside proctors, and the outside proctors, they must be professionals, so we must pay them extra. All right. So that's one of the reasoning behind this methodology. Notice, examinees are only permitted to access to those resources allowed to be brought into the examination, right? As listed in CBP.gov, we just seen it. But wait for the notice of examination to be sure what those resources are. In my experience, and customs has been on and off about this, is they used to be really strict at first. You can only bring certain things such as HTSUS, you can bring CFR, you can bring directives, and nothing more. Watches, calculators, and things like that. Then they allowed to bring notes. Then they allowed to bring what's called a cheat sheet. It's not really a cheat sheet. It's really the summary or outline of relevant topics that that examinees, exam takers, are trying to prepare. So it's more relaxed. So pretty much now, as long as it's paper, at least up to now, as long as it's paper, you could bring it to the exam site, and you would be able to use it. Whether that will stay or not, I do not know. We have to see, but and we have to wait for the notice of examination. So next, let's take a look at the next relevant highlight. So again, fourth Monday of April and October, we talked about that. The shift from 200 to 390, so almost the fee to sit on the exam almost doubles. Of course, if you don't, so it is less expensive for you to pass it on the first time. So it's better to give it a shot. The current paper-based examination will soon no longer be available and shift into all electronic examination. Goes back to that computer thing. All right, so the requirements don't change, right? They list some of the current criteria, right? So this will change. A quick note on the federal government employees. So I've seen some of the folks. And again, that position has not been over set in stone. Around early 2000s, they shifted that. They used to allow federal government employees to take the exam. But once they apply for the license, they have to quit their job as a federal government employee because there is a conflict of interest. Now, customs say, no, you can't be a US federal government employee if you sit for the exam. And that position remains to this day. So if you are like Postal Service, USPS employee, that's federal government, it can be a problem. Citizenship is required. 18 years of age. So if you're going to college, if you just finished high school, you can do that. But here's a catch. If you pass and you're 18 years old, you have to wait 3 years until you become 21 to apply for a license. Because license is only given to 21-year-olds, not 18-year-olds. Okay, so here is a current status of the time requirements, 4.5 hours. You have about 80 questions. And notice, look at this interesting statistic. CBP estimates that there will be approximately 2,600 examinees per year or 1,300 per session countrywide. So this is how many people are interested in taking the exam. Is this a big number? Well, compared to folks interested in becoming attorneys, probably not so big. The upside of this number is that the prerequisites are not as stringent for this type of exam as for others. So if you are, let's say, making an application to practice before US Patent Office to prosecute patents, you have to have an educational background at the level of Master of Science, and among other things, good moral character, etc., etc. Here, there is no really educational background, so you don't even need to finish high school if you just to sit there. Of course, you have to know how to read and write, you have to speak English, and all those wonderful things. But it's really essential that the entrance itself, the bar, just to get a seat at the table, is not that high. The problem is that once you get that ticket, in order to successfully take advantage of that exam ticket, you have to put in a lot of time and effort. So that's the downside, because the fail rates are quite substantial. All right, moving on. So it used to be that they go to ports and hotels, so they would rent out a ballroom space in a hotel and stuff it with tables and just crumble people in. Now it will be what they call formal testing location. What that testing location is like, it remains to be seen. I suspect it will be much like testing location for like TOEFL, SAT, and other centers which already have computerized centers, just simply for that purpose, with additional program customized to customs broker exam available. All right. Here's an interesting chart. It's not that important for our purpose, but just I think what customs tries to do is they try to say that the cost the doubling almost doubling of the fees just like over like 95% or something increase is not significant. So what they do is they take the figures from the NAICS code, which is administered by Census, and they say, okay, so the probably weighted average revenue for the small business for this code, which includes not only customs brokers but also freight forwarders, so transportation companies in general, is about $1.5 million, approximately, right? So because the small businesses make $1.5 million, this $190 increase will be this much and is very small. And because of that, we think it's insignificant impact. True or not true, I don't know, it remains to be seen. All right, so then they show how the regulations will be amended. For our purposes, it's really not that important for now. But pretty much those. So we saw from the history, go from 1800s, 1894. We see the progression and solidification of the regulation of the profession as a licensed customs broker, as well as. As the march to the 21st century, so it's we are almost in 2020s. We are getting close there, and customs is beginning to introduce computer instead of the paper. Great stuff. At least I'm hoping that it will be great stuff, and the other things. So be mindful of this. And let's go to the, let's go to the outline, which puts all the stuff in a context. All right, so. So. Introduction. All right, so. And this outline is a bare bones stuff. So we talked about the citizenship, the age requirement, the employment for the federal government. By the way, the federal government does not mean state government. So if you work for the New York City, let's say, you're okay. If you work for New York State or Minnesota state government, you're okay. It only pertains to the federal government. All right. Registration requirement, they're pretty much listed on this procedures and the way the registration works. So you have you go to the customs broker dedicated web page and you see this customs broker license examination, right? Oops, no, we don't want to do that. All right, so to register, so this is October, so we are past that, okay? Customs will update this soon, but essentially the point is that you go to this link. Rather, to make it easier, you just go through this path name. And those path names are on the left-hand corner, and you arrive to the notice of examination. And notice of examination will advise you of what to bring to the, or what you need to prepare for the exam, and would also provide you with the registration link where you will need to pay.